I'm Kat Toups, and I practice functional medicine psychiatry in the San Francisco East Bay area. I've been doing that for the past several years. I got into functional medicine, like many people do, from my own chronic immune illnesses and realizing the limitations of traditional Western medicine in learning how to get well. So I came to the functional medicine table probably starting in 2009. I eventually became certified with the Institute for Functional Medicine as a certified practitioner. I treat probably the sickest of the sick these days because I have an emphasis on the brain and cognition and psychiatric problems. I have people that have the whole gamut of the physical problems and the mental problems. And because of that, I have gotten deeper and deeper into working with infections that seem to be causing a lot of the neuropsychiatric problems. It was not something I had much experience with when I started practicing functional medicine, and I would say a large majority of my patients can get improvement pretty quickly with a functional method, working with their diet, their nutrition, their nutrient levels, their toxins, their hormones, you know, those kind of things. But I have a subset of patients that are getting some improvement, but I haven't gotten them well, and hence I started digging deeper, looking for what else is going on with these people, and that has led me to looking at some of the infections that affect the central nervous system, and Lyme has certainly reared its head as one of those infections. So it seems like lately, as I've found a little bit better testing methods, I'm starting to identify Lyme more and more in some of my very chronically ill patients. It's hard to say exactly how many people that I have in my practice that I'm treating with Lyme, but recently I started using some different testing methods, and I would say probably in the last couple of months, I've picked up maybe 10 patients in my caseload that are actually testing positive for Lyme now. They might have had one or two bands positive on the Western blot with Quest labs, but using a different company, I'm finding more sensitivity and identifying it. And these are people that I'm looking because their symptomatology is making me think that there is something like Lyme going on. I don't test everybody for Lyme. Certainly not all of my patients have symptoms that are consistent with Lyme disease, but I do have certain patients that come in and have such multi-system illness. They have symptoms in so many diffuse areas that I start thinking, what can do something like this? What is a unifying feature? And Lyme certainly comes to mind at that point. You know, it's called the great imitator, much like lupus. It can affect any system in the body. And so when people are coming in with psychiatric symptoms and pain symptoms and sensitivity to temperature, they can't regulate their temperature, they're sensitive to light, they're having sound distortions or hearing problems, just paresthesias, a wide variety of symptoms. When there's symptoms in so many different areas, that's when I start thinking that I better be looking for something like Lyme or maybe also mycotoxin illness. I'm seeing pretty similar gender effects with Lyme. Here in California, people are pretty oriented toward the outdoors. Most of my patients are pretty active, and so I don't really see any differences in my population here between men and women. So I think that it might be skewed toward thinking it's more women because probably I have a lot more women in my practice. I think women certainly manifest a lot more immune symptomatology than men in general is kind of what we've seen historically, but I also think women are more likely to come in for treatment and more open to discussing some of these symptoms that other people think are crazy. It's incumbent upon us to support the immune system. So many people get Lyme and they're able to clear it. They get a slight infection. They might feel like they have the flu over the weekend and their immune system takes care of it. And those aren't the people we have to worry about. But we have some people that have loading genetically. They might have a genetic HLA type, the HLA-DR, that makes them susceptible to developing chronic Lyme with an infection. They may have problems with their GI system, their diet, their gut might not be working well. And of course, most of our immune system is in our gut. 60% is in the gut. So if people have GI problems, their immune system already is going to be compromised. And so people with various other factors happening are the ones that will get into trouble with chronic Lyme. And so the first way I see my job is to support their immune system. If we can support the immune system and get that working better, then maybe they can clear the infection and not require chronic antibiotic therapy. So the first thing that I do is work with their diet. I mean, if people are not eating well, if you know, food has the power to you know, turn on good genes and turn on bad genes. And so if people aren't eating well, there's no way that we can support their immune system to get better. So that's the first place that we start. What are you eating? And work with the diet, and then work with the health of the gut. So I do testing in all my patients at the first visit. I do comprehensive stool analysis testing, and I look for bacterial overgrowth, yeast overgrowth, parasites. What are their inflammatory markers? How are they digesting their food? You know, what are their basic probiotic levels there? And so to me, that's kind of the first level. I also look at nutrient levels. There's various nutrients, magnesium, zinc, some of the B vitamins that all affect how the immune system works. So trying to bring all those things into balance are going to be my first way that I work with treating people with any kind of infection. So with the diets, there's no one-size-fits-all diet. Some people do better with plant-based diets. Some people do better with paleo diets with more meat and animal products. The key thing with everybody's diet is that they definitely need to eat whole foods that are not packaged and processed, because those are robbed of their nutrients. It's really important that in whatever diet people choose, that they eat lots of vegetables. I've had people come into me that are vegetarian and don't eat any vegetables. It's really important in my mind to take out in foods that are inflammatory. So anything that's inflaming the gut is going to compromise the immune system. So for me, it's very important to ask people to take out gluten. We have plenty of data that that's a very inflammatory food. It's been modified. It's not been genetically modified, but it's been hybridized so that it contains more and more gluten, and we just don't seem to digest that anymore. And so it doesn't matter to me if people are allergic or not. It's just going to compromise their gut function. And if I want to heal their immune system, I need to start by healing their gut. So that's kind of my line in the sand. I ask all patients to stop the gluten. Some patients, I ask them to stop all grains, especially those with neurodegenerative symptoms. The grains have been implicated in affecting the brain in many ways. Another important factor with the grains is the sugar content. So they're very high in sugar. The glycemic index is 20% higher than table sugar with wheat. And so one important part of settling down someone's immune system, there's so many factors. You have to look at all the factors that are out of balance. And for a lot of people, it's their blood sugar regulation. So many people have prediabetes that I'm seeing. And so eliminating the grains helps to regulate the blood sugar. The dairy for some people is inflammatory. It's the second most common food allergy that we have. We know it elevates insulin growth factor 1, which is implicated in cancers and other inflammatory disorders. So especially for people that have problems with sinus allergies that give me a history of early ear infections and throat infections, those are people I like to stop the dairy with as well. So that molluscum it happens in people that are immunocompromised. So, you know, when something's wrong with the immune system. And so we know that if you're eating foods that you're allergic to, that's going to be activating your immune system and, you know, ultimately depleting the resources of your immune system to fight with other things like comorbid infections. I use a lot of LDN in my practice. I work with people with all kinds of immune disorders, and LDN has been a wonderful tool in the toolkit. Obviously, there's no one thing that gets people better. It's really important for us to look at all the factors. But for immune support, it's been quite a help for many of my patients. Some patients with LDN start to see benefits almost immediately, and others it may take a month or two or three. Typically, the teaching is that you would try it for 3 months before deciding it wasn't doing anything. But I like LDN for a variety of targets, not only the immune targets, but I use it a lot for mood disorders. From the minute I learned of LDN and its mechanism of action, that it increases opiates, as a psychiatrist, I was curious, what will this do for people's mood disorders? And lo and behold, it's actually quite effective for certain patients, helping their anxiety and also depression. With any kind of immune disorders, and you know, certainly Lyme with all of its neuropsychiatric problems and presentation affecting the brain, anxiety is a pretty common denominator. So typically when people have leaky brain and the inflammatory cytokines are crossing over into their brain, one of the first symptoms that I do see is anxiety. So I find that LDN, in addition to being helpful for their immune support, it is helpful for their mood support. When I first started using LDN, like pretty much everybody else, I gave it at bedtime, and if people were troubled by the dreams and the insomnia, we'd switch it to the daytime, and it still worked. Last year at the LDN Research Trust annual conference, they had two psychologists that were presenting data on using it during the daytime for veterans with PTSD and finding that it was helpful for that. And I thought that was fantastic information, and started actually prescribing it from the get-go for a lot of my patients during the daytime rather than at nighttime, so they could benefit from those increased endorphins during the daytime. When people do take LDN at bedtime, they certainly still have increased endorphins during the daytime that can help the moods. But what I've learned is when people take it in the daytime, it doesn't affect people's heads, it doesn't make them sedated, but it gives a sense of quietness internally. It makes people feel just a little more peaceful and less reactive. And that's actually very important for people suffering from neuropsychiatric Lyme, because there is so much agitation, there's so much angst. People's bodies are letting them down, their minds are letting them down. And so I really like LDN for that effect, that it gives that internal quietness for people that is helpful. With regards to other physicians' perspectives on LDN, it's mixed. Some people just say, I don't know anything about it, and I can't really advise you on that. I've had some physicians that were vehemently opposed to using LDN, and I had one patient who had an outside psychiatrist at Kaiser who refused to treat that patient if he continued on the LDN. And it was a really tough position for my patient to be in, because that psychiatrist had been helpful for him, but it was clear to the patient and his family that he was doing so much better on the LDN that they terminated from that physician. So it's a very sad thing for me that people's ignorance, you know, causes them to put patients in a bind like that. At this point, I use LDN for all of my Lyme patients because it is a disorder that compromises the immune system, so I'm looking for any kind of immune support I can get. I would say my first stunning success with LDN in a patient with Lyme came with working with a friend of mine. And this was a good friend of mine who had developed quite a severe illness from both Lyme and Babesia. She was very, very ill. Her brain was completely demented. She could hardly feed herself or figure out how to get dressed. I sent her to see one of my colleagues who is a Lyme literate doctor, and he was treating her with the herbal antimicrobials. And I suggested that we start the LDN. Well, her Lyme specialist said, I'm not sure we should do that because we won't know what's doing what if she gets better. And I said, as long as she gets better, I don't really care what's doing what. Let's go ahead and try it. So I put her on LDN, and I would say within a month of getting to the target dose, it was like a switch had flipped. Her brain started working. She went right back to work. It was quite a dramatic improvement. So I think that was my first really clear hit that the LDN was quite effective in this case for Lyme. You could say that, yes, she was being treated with herbal antimicrobials, but typically that's kind of a slow process, and I don't see people reconstitute that quickly, which this was really almost overnight from one day to the next. Yeah, I do think that LDN accelerates the recovery period for people. It just provides such a level of immune support that it does seem to accelerate the process. It is a slow process for many people that have had, I mean, I've had people that have been sick for so long that they're not gonna get better overnight. But in this particular patient of mine, it was quite a dramatic improvement, and it really was almost overnight. And she certainly feels like it was from the LDN, and that's what it appeared to be. We have really nice data for other effects on the immune system in the form of meditation, mindfulness, and exercise. So meditation and exercise are the clearest things that we know that can affect the brain. And of course, the brain is directing everything, you know, with the immune system and the HPA axis that gets disrupted with Lyme. So anything we can do to support our brain function obviously is going to be a benefit. So for me, it is really important that in addition to the diet, that my patients are doing something for stress reduction and working with some kind of mindfulness. There's lots of ways to do that. I try to meet people with where they are. Some people are already experienced meditators, and that's a great thing. Some people do Tai Chi or Qigong, that's a great thing. People can do guided meditations. There's a beautiful study that I read where people did guided meditations every day for 8 weeks, and they did head scans at the beginning and the end, and at the end of 8 weeks their hippocampus was enlarged, and that is responsible for our memory and our emotions. So you know, just doing something as simple as listening to a guided meditation for 15 or 20 minutes a day can make a difference for people. And then exercise is tricky because some people are in so much pain and they have so much fatigue that they're not going to be able to exercise. So you kind of have to grade that with where people are. But the ones that are able, and as they improve, exercise certainly can have great immune benefits for people. Not all patients that have Lyme have neuropsychiatric problems, but of course the ones that I am seeing as a functional psychiatrist do. And it can be quite horrifying for people, terrifying for people. Their brain just gets activated in all kinds of strange ways, and it's exquisitely sensitive to sensory input, to emotional input. People are activated in a way that every little thing that happens feels like the straw that breaks the camel's back. So things that stressors they could have normally coped with easily turn them into blithering idiots. And so people with neuropsychiatric Lyme need a lot of support, and it's really difficult because we don't have, at least in my area, we don't have any inpatient treatment facilities, residential treatment facilities, but some people are in, their brains are so inflamed that they really need to be cared for. There's a technique called DNRS, Dynamic Neuro Retraining System, and it's a technique about rewiring your brain, and it was developed for people with multiple chemical sensitivity, chronic illnesses like Lyme, EMF sensitivity, and this technique is based on the idea that the brain directs everything, and when we're sick, our brain gets stuck in these loops, and it keeps, every little thing makes us sick, so it keeps giving us a fear response. This is going to make me sick, and I am sick. And the more we keep thinking about those things over and over, the more it strengthens those neuronal tracks in our brain. So this kind of practice teaches that if you can try to forget about those factors and do a practice where you support new wiring in your brain, that you can actually get well. And they have some great successes. I went and participated in one of their four-day workshops, and I watched people in the course of 4 days that were extremely ill shift quite dramatically. And they definitely have worked with people that have had Lyme disease before. At the course, they showed some videos, and there was one of a young man with Lyme that had tried everything and dramatically did better with this course. So people don't have to go to a four-day training. It's something that you can purchase their DVDs and learn this practice. And it's not any one practice that makes people better. That practice incorporates mindfulness, tapping, positive affirmations, laughter yoga. So any kind of ways that we can shift our brain to starting to think about ourselves as healthy instead of ill can have really great ramifications for the immune system. Laughter yoga, you can look at funny videos on Facebook or YouTube, you know, the laughing baby videos that are so infectious. That releases endorphins or opiates, which is, of course, one reason we use the LDN to support that system, because we know that those opiates bind to our T regulatory cells, and we know that that helps our immune system. So I love these ideas that there are different things we can do to support our immune system by, you know, working with laughter, with breathing, with mindfulness. And mindfulness, I tell my patients, it's any time that you come out of your head and into your body and be present. So you can go on a nice walk in nature, and you can listen to the birds and smell the smells and leave your cell phone behind. And that's just being present, and that's mindfulness. You can wash the dishes and, you know, focus on your breathing. And those we know from cognitive neuroscience that 12 minutes a day of meditation can literally change your brain. And they can see now that it can change brain structure. And those 12 minutes don't have to be all together. So you could, I tell my patients, spend 4 minutes in the morning, you know, before you get out of bed, just do some breathing or some grounding, and, you know, do that before you go to sleep, and do it some other time in the day. So little brief breaks. You don't have to sit in lotus position for half an hour and, you know, completely shut off all your thoughts. Another technique that I like is heart math. I call it meditation for non-meditators. So heart math has a device now that you can purchase and upload to your cell phone, and they work with heart rate variability, and they put a little sensor on your ear, and it measures the variability in your heart rates, and they synchronize that with your breathing. And so in order to utilize that program, basically they tell you when to breathe in and when to breathe out. And that's kind of all you need to do. They suggest that you think about breathing in and out from your heart. And after you get your breathing going, you think of someone you love, which is endorphins, another effect, you know, that we get from the LDN, but we can do it ourselves by thinking of someone we love or somebody that we're grateful for. And they have beautiful data showing, you know, what happens with the stress response. And we know that the stress response impairs the immune response. So if we can modulate our stress, then we can support our immune systems. So I think there's just many things that we can do between, you know, mindfulness, breathing, meditation, exercise, dancing. I suggest for some patients, I say, you know, once a day, I want you to crank up a really good song and dance around your kitchen with abandon, and that will give them a little immune boost. So there's many ways to support your immune system besides, you know, all of the other methods we have to use with antimicrobials and the like.